So far, we've looked only at shallow water sediments, but of course, a vessel like the Chikiyu or even the Jordis Resolution, they're designed to drill in any water depth, including the deep ocean. And it'd be interesting to know what happens in terms of rhythmicity, not just in shallow water deposits, but also in deep water. Added to this, we probably want to have a deeper understanding of what controls this rhythmic deposition, both in shallow water and in deep water. And for this, we need to talk about the different types of control that we have, types of cyclicity if you want, and also what controls them. There's really two different types of cycles we can recognize. One is called autocyclic. Autocyclic systems are essentially forced from within the basin itself. So good example of autocyclic processes include, for instance, sedimentation, switching in lobes, so things that are internal to the sedimentary systems. Now, the opposition to autocyclic sequences is allocyclic sequences that are basically controlled by external forcing. That includes tectonic, and it also includes eustacy. So you already know, you're already familiar with this concept because in sequence stratigraphy, we talked about the sea level control or the eustatic control on base level change, and also the tectonic control on base level change. And one of the main parameters that control the energy that the Earth is receiving, and thus by extension climate, sea level, and sediments, is the so-called Milankovitch cycles. And these are driven by orbital parameters. And there's three types of orbital parameters that you need to know: eccentricity, the tilt of the Earth's orbit, or obliquity, and precession. So let's review them. Eccentricity is essentially the shape of the Earth's orbits. And you can see on this animation from NASA that this shape is changing through geological time. And how eccentric that orbit is, so how much of an ellipse it is as opposed to something more circular, more of a circle, really determines how much energy the Earth is receiving as a total. There's a frequency of the change in eccentricity, and it's recognized that the two main frequencies that we see over geological timescales are cycles of 100,000 years and 413,000 years. So relatively long-term cycles, almost half a million years, 413,000 years and 100,000 years. And in the recent geological past, so in the last 1.8 million years, the Earth has been dominated by a 400K eccentricity cycle. But before that, the 100K cycles were dominated. And it's still a little bit unclear why that change occurred when it occurred, but it had a profound implication on ice ages. The next important parameter to understand, or a Milankovitch parameter, is the obliquity, or the tilt of the Earth's axis. As you know, the Earth's axis is tilted with respect to the plane of the solar system, and that tilt varies over time between 22.1 to 24.5 degrees. And how tilted the Earth's axis is has tremendous implication for how much energy the poles are receiving. And of course, you can imagine that if the energy that is distributed to the pole varies through time, the ability of the poles to sustain ice cap will vary through time as well, and this is going to have a big implication on how much volume of ice you have on the Earth, and so sea level and climate. And obliquity has mainly a frequency of 41,000 years, so this is a cycle that happens with a main period of 41,000 years. Now, the last one of the orbital parameters, or Milankovitch parameters, that you need to understand is precession. Now, precession is the wobble of that Earth's axis. And so that implies that with this wobble, it's not always the same side of the Earth that is pointing towards the sun during the winter and the summer. So it has implication on seasonality. How strong are the summer, how hot are they, and how cold are the winter. So again, potentially impacts how much ice can be preserved on the poles. The main frequency for precession, actually there's several, they range from 19,000 years to 23,000 years. And of course, there is also a 100,000 year frequency, but that's essentially 4 of the 23,000 year cycles, and it's modulated by eccentricity. So that's something that's really important to understand, is that eccentricity, obliquity, and precession actually play together to control the insulation that the Earth is receiving over time. And we can represent this insulation here. This is from Colossi 2011, but the data is from Berger and Lutre in 1991. And the first thing to realize is we're looking at a time series. So we have geological time here in the past, up to 100,000 years in the past, but you could build that to much older time series. And what's interesting is to look at the insulation. So we're looking here at the June mid-month insulation. So that's the northern summer. So if you look at the distribution of the energy on the Earth, you can see that obviously the equators are here. So we have about 400 watts per square meter. But look at how this oscillates through time. It's not always constant. And if we look at the northern hemisphere, so again, this is the summer in the northern hemisphere, you can see that we have about 500 watts per square meter at 30 degrees latitude north. At 60 degrees latitude north, it's about similar, and the blue line represents the pole at 90 degree latitude north, and it receives actually a tremendous amount of watts per square meter of energy. And also the fluctuation, so the difference between a high and a low in terms of the geological past changes a lot. So by extension, this means that this will have a tremendous impact on paleoclimate and the ability to sustain ice caps on the northern hemisphere. And because we're looking at the northern hemisphere summer, it's the winter in the southern hemisphere, so much less oscillation, much less energy at 30 degrees south, and almost nothing at 60 degrees south, because we are in the polar winter and there's very little light coming on the Earth on the polar winter. But the point I want to make is that those orbital frequency impact insulation. That insulation really determines how much ice you can preserve on the high latitude, and that by extension means what the climate is and what sea level is doing, and so that has naturally an impact on our sedimentary record. To drive this point home, I want to show you the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere in the modern day. You can see we have very little ice coverage here in the modern day on the northern hemisphere, just a little bit on Greenland. We have some sea ice. And of course, we have on Antarctica a large polar ice cap, which is a ground-based polar ice cap. But if we were to take this to the last 18,000 years, you can see that in the northern hemisphere, we have this, this is the last glacial maximum. We have this very extensive grounded ice on land that extends over Siberia, but also North America. And also we have more sea ice on Antarctica and essentially a larger ice cap. So really those Milankovic cycles, these Milankovic or orbital parameters, play a big role in controlling Earth's systems and the climate. As a reminder, you've seen when we talked about oxygen isotopes that the delta 18 of the seawater will change depending on how much ice volume we have on the continent. So by extension, those Milankovic cycles have an impact on delta 18 in the ocean, as recorded in benthic forms or planktonic forms, because it impacts both ice volume, but also temperature.